Welcome back to my YouTube film review channel. And I've had another email from my regular correspondent, Id Idworth, who says, "Dear Pete, in terms of subscribers, your channel is putting up some pretty underwhelming numbers. But it could be that at some stage you will reach a tipping point and explode into global viral success. Or alternatively, your subscriber levels will just plateau and stagnate like your Twitter following." Oh, thank you, Id. You had to go there, didn't you? I want to talk about a fascinating novel that's been republished this week. Most people will know Emeric Pressburger as the brilliant screenwriter and, with Michael Powell, the co-director of British cinema classics like The Red Shoes, Black Narcissus and The Life and Death of Colonel Blimp. His biography was written by his grandson, the director Kevin MacDonald. But Pressburger was also a novelist, with Killing a Mouse on Sunday in 1961, set in the Spanish Civil War and filmed as Behold a Pale Horse. But his second novel, The Glass Pearls, in 1966, was largely ignored, an injustice that Faber is now correcting, having already republished it in 2015, and now again with an introduction by the critic and author Anthony Quinn. And in literary terms, this could be Pressburger's masterpiece. The story concerns a shy, well-mannered, intelligent man who works in London as a piano tuner in what is evidently the mid-60s, although this isn't a particularly swinging London. It could be the London of the 50s or the 40s. He is called Karl Braun, and his fellow lodgers at the boarding house understand that he is a German émigré, a refugee from Nazism, who is pursuing a compensation claim from the West German state. Karl lives a modest life, enlivened by his new romantic attraction to a divorced woman who works in the letting agent's office that found him his room. But Karl has a secret. He is, in fact, Otto Reitmüller, a Nazi doctor like Joseph Mengele, guilty of horrendous brain operations in the camps, and now on the run. Karl Braun thinks of himself as a nice, cultured man who has accepted his current circumstances with humility and grace. The frisson of evil that hums underneath this story is unsettling. It's a story that might have interested Powell and Pressburger as filmmakers in its mood of shabbiness and loneliness. It's not unlike Powell's solo movie Peeping Tom, and it's also very Hitchcockian, particularly the spectacular location for its set-piece finale, the vast rockfield site of Caillou de Montpellier-le-Vieux in the south of France. It's a little like The Man Who Knew Too Much. But also in the dreary sadness of the boarding house and the nasty little secret of fascism, it has a lot of Patrick Hamilton. It's a tremendous novel. Check it out for your summer reading. Perry Henzel's visceral 1972 Jamaican crime drama The Harder They Come is now on re-release.
I could make a record.
This crunchily powerful film exists between the two moods of its two most famous tracks, the aspirational lesson of "you can get it if you really want" and the downfall premonition of the title song. The desperado here really wants it, really gets it, comes hard and falls hard. It's a movie with Arthur Penn's Bonnie and Clyde in its DNA, and also Sergio Corbucci's spaghetti western Django, which in one scene is shown getting a rowdy screening in a Kingston cinema. Singer Jimmy Cliff plays Ivanhoe. The comparison with Sir Walter Scott probably ends there, although the name is a reminder of the British colonial hangover. He's a gawky country boy who comes to the Jamaican capital, Kingston, yearning to be a famous recording star. Swaggeringly laid-back Ivan, as he's called, gets a job in a repair shop on land owned by the local church, and he soon takes a shine to Elsa, played by Janet Bartley, the demure young orphan parishioner being kept, or rather groomed, as a virginal ward by the hectoring, controlling preacher, played by Basil Keane, who is creepily planning to marry her. Ivan and Elsa start their secret affair as Ivan begins his twin careers in music and crime, only to be strangled in both by monopolistic capitalism. He records a catchy single, The Harder They Come, for a local recording studio boss who forces him to accept a flat buyout fee of $20 and blocks him from selling his single directly to radio stations and clubs. While his pop stardom fails to materialise, Ivan gets into the ganja distribution business in a small way, retailing pre-rolled spliffs, only to find that the colossally lucrative wholesale US export action is sewn up by top mobster Jose, played by Carl Bradshaw. The reggae soundtrack throbs and crunches and shudders in concert with the raw energy of Hensel's storytelling and Cliff's performance, but this doesn't preclude a shrewdly sophisticated and self-aware debate about representation. Ivan may not be an existential hero, but he knows he is going to die in the very near future, and this conviction accelerates his celebrity and his fanatical devotion to the swiftly dwindling moment of defiance. His fall is indeed hard. Like the cowboys he watches on screen, Ivan has a blood-in-the-sand reckoning with fate. That's it. Please give this YouTube channel a like and a share on social media, and very importantly, subscribe. And leave a comment to say that you've subscribed and what your star sign is. And also, buy my book, The Films That Made Me, an edited selection of my essays and reviews for The Guardian. I'm away on holiday now, but please tune in a couple of weeks.